following is an exclusive presentation of TPC Communications. Pitt may never be tested emotionally the way they were tested on Saturday. Against a surprising, fired-up Boston College team, they were forced to come up with big play after big play. And they did. And just barely got away with a 29-24 win. And after seven games, Pitt is still undefeated. Last week, Syracuse sent Pitt a message. Don't take any team lightly. This week, Pitt went on the road and they got the same message, only this time it was delivered louder and longer by Boston College. But the important thing is that Pitt is still undefeated, although they just might be a little emotionally drained, too. It was that kind of a game. Boston College was fired up from the beginning and they stayed that way right to the end, and they stayed in the game right to the end because of a freshman quarterback named Doug Flutie, who apparently hadn't been told that he was playing against the number one defense in the country. And apparently nobody had told Flutie's favorite receiver, Brian Brennan, either. It seemed the tougher the Pitt defense made it for Flutie, the better he got. The Pitt offense looked like it was ready to go to work on a blowout in the first half, and the man who was discovered 3 weeks ago, Brian Thomas, seems to become a bigger part of the offense every week. But when a 6-0 team plays a 2-4 team, usually the only way the 2-4 team is going to win is by the turnover. And Pitt almost died by the turnover on Saturday. But the Pitt defense has made forcing that big turnover its specialty all season long. And it was the defense that kept Pitt's hopes for an undefeated season alive this week. There were so many big defensive plays in this game that it's almost impossible to pick out the biggest. But here's one that'll get a lot of votes. With Pitt leading by 5 in the fourth quarter and BC first and goal at the 9, Al Wenglikowski makes the big hit. Rich Kranak finishes him off, and Michael Woods gets the ball back. We'll have all the action and the story of Panther Pride, which is brought to you by Westinghouse and the 140,000 Westinghouse employees worldwide. By Miller High Life, if you've got the time, we've got the beer. And by Gulf Oil, who suggests you try Gulf Super Unleaded, the gas with guts. It helps eliminate knocks and pings. All week, the talk had been that Pitt had learned from the Syracuse game that they had to take every opponent seriously, even if their record was 2-4. But the offense stalled on the first two possessions. This screen to DeBartola came up short. And it was fourth down. And this was a sign of things to come. David Hepler's punt is blocked. And Boston College was at the 8. But the Pitt defense got tough. Pozzoli and Pelusi stopped Brown. The razzle-dazzle didn't work either. Thanks to Pappy Thomas. So Boston College had to settle for 3, but it was 3 more than Pitt had, and for the second week in a row, Pitt was behind early. Even though they were behind, Pitt still decided to stick with a game plan.
We had to establish some run offense right from the beginning, but in the same sense, because of what they do in coverage-wise, we think we could throw the ball underneath short passes and then hopefully go for the long one and be able to get it, because their tendency is to maybe give the underneath a little bit, and we thought we would just utilize or take advantage of that and then go over the top a little bit.
And Brian Thomas kept making that game plan look like a good one. After a slow start this season, John Brown has come on to be as important as any receiver Dan Marino has.
Well, it was just a crossing route, and I slipped in behind the linebackers, and it's kind of, you know, I'm coming behind people, and we have our backs and receivers taking everybody in all different directions. I slipped behind the linebackers. Danny made a great throw, and it was there.
Boston College had a game plan of their own. It was called Let Flutie Throw, mostly down the middle. Thank you. In the second quarter, the corner fire was on, but Flutie goes down the middle again, and BC is on the pit eight again. The big Boston College offensive line opens a big hole, and Pitt's behind for the second time in the game. Seven yards deep isn't too deep for Tim Lewis. He takes it out. And he takes it out to good field position for Pitt. Dan Marino wanted those seven back in a hurry. First, he goes to Dwight Collins. And now back to the tight end. And that's close enough. Collins is man-to-man in the end zone, and Pitt is in the lead. And the plan is working.
We don't try to switch up on anything, just me and Dwight personally. All the things that we run are all game plan, and we practice them all week.
And that practice pays off with this one. Pitt would get tired of looking at this guy before the day was out. Brian Brennan. Doug Flutie never got tired of throwing into the middle, though, not when his receivers had this much room. Flutie also found that the way to neutralize the pass rush was to throw on the run. Boston College may have had some success throwing on Saturday, but it was a little different story on the run. This was still the number one defense in the country, and Bill Moss has been a big part of that all season long. So was Dave Pizzoli. And it's contact like this that makes good, safe equipment important.
The violence in college football, which people talk about, is really, it hasn't changed. We're a lot safer today. The injuries are a lot less. The medical treatment, prevention of injuries are much greater. It is a contact sport, and it's going to be, always be a contact sport, but it's a lot safer today than it was 10, 20, 30 years ago. The safety factor that we stress, that the people stress, the amount of money that we put into equipment and test equipment to make it safer, has certainly benefited our players, and it has made the game safer. Probably the two most important things that a young man can think about wearing is the headgear and the shoes. Some of the features that have changed, even in the headgear, is we've gone to a four-point chin strap, which a four-point chin strap keeps the helmet in place. The helmet today is extremely safer. Years ago, when we had a lot of problems with young people, players getting hurt on artificial turf, they were blaming the turf. It's not the turf so much as it was maybe the equipment we were wearing, for instance, the shoe. When we play on grass, we have different types of grass shoes. There's a lot of different types of turf shoes, but these are two basic shoes that we wear. One of them is when the turf is dry, then you have more friction, and then when the turf is wet. When the turf is wet, then we wear a different type of shoe because you have to. Because the traction of it is not as good as it is when it's dry. The equipment is extremely a lot better, and every year they're coming up or testing and coming up with new equipment and making it safer for that player.
You're never safe when you're in your own territory throwing against the Pitt defense. And Pappy Thomas is in the right place on this one.
Our defense and our offense based on making the big plays, and that was one of the big plays for us, because like as soon as we got the interception, we drove down the score. So that was a big play for us.
Pappy Thomas's interception made it possible for the other Thomas to go to work on this drive. And Jackie Sherrill is getting this Thomas into the offense more and more each week. Here's 11 more right here. And 11 here. And six more for Pitt.
It was a sweep. And
and we strung them out pretty well. There was a cut back there. Wayne made the block on the linebacker, and I just cut back, and it was a big hole. I just took it in.
And Pitt took it into the locker room 20-10, but this one was a long way from over. Jackie Sherrill would have liked and probably expected more than a 10-point cushion going into the third quarter. The Pitt defense was still playing the run tough, and they played as though they wanted to make sure Jackie didn't have too much to worry about in the second half. Good pressure here by Dolman, and some good pursuit by Pelosi, and it's fourth down, but just barely. And it's time for a gift. There's no easier way than that to get 2 points. Now the offense would try to put this one away. And they would try to do it with Brian Thomas. This would be the last time that the offense would have any real success moving the ball. And on this series, Brian Thomas was having a lot of success. Brian Thomas for 10 more. It was Brian Thomas who set up the touchdown with runs like this. And he sets up Dan Marino, and it looks like blowout time. Then maybe freshmen don't know what a blowout is. Flutie seems to think he's still in the game. And his favorite receiver, Brian Brennan, seems to just keep getting open. A penalty helps this drive go as far as the 12-yard line before Michael Woods decided enough was enough. And it was 4th and 18 at the 23. Good coverage at the 5. And the defense has stopped BC again. But after a punt, BC has it back. And Flutie goes right back to the pass, and watch this catch. And the middle is still wide open. One of 8 catches right here for Brian Brennan. The rollout worked in the first half, and it's still working. Boston College is on the 37. 2 plays later on 1st and 10 from the 30, Flutie goes for it all, and he gets it. And Boston College is right back in the game. And this one was good, even though Troy Hill got a piece of it. Nothing for Pitt on their next possession, and Flutie is still trying to throw. Not with too much success this time. But he has a lot of success running out of the pocket on 3rd and 17, and all of a sudden, it's 1st down, BC. The third quarter ends, and Boston College is still very much alive. On the first play of the fourth quarter, Pappy Thomas takes a little life out of them with his 2nd interception. A 15-yard penalty on this play puts Pitt back on their 16. But Pitt didn't have the ball for long. On the first play from the 16, this is Brian Thomas, and that's a fumble. And Boston College is at the Pitt 21, and now they really smell upset. Doug Flutie hasn't looked like a freshman quarterback yet, and he sees no reason to start now. On second down, it's touchdown, Boston College. And you should be hearing quite a bit about this kid over the next 3 years. This is a clinic on the rollout pass, and Pitt's lead is cut to 5. Now it's up to the offense to hold on to the ball and eat up the clock. Thomas goes for 8 to the 19. But 3 plays later, Marino overthrows Collins in the flat, and it looks like the defense is going to have to save this one. On 2nd and 3 at the Pitt 30, the defense needs a big play and gets one from Michael Woods. A broken play and a good play brings up 4th and 3. Flutie misses an open receiver on 4th and 3, and Pitt gets a break and gets the ball back and holds on to the 5-point lead for now. But the offense was only able to hold the ball for 2 plays. On 3rd and 2 at the 37, Marino is intercepted again. And this time, Dan Marino makes a big defensive play. This tackle right here may have kept Pitt undefeated. And BC is 1st and goal at the 9. Pitt needs the big play on defense again, and Michael Woods comes up with it again. It was Woods who recovered the fumble, but Alan Wenglikowski and Rich Kranak had a lot to do with it. And the Boston College threat lasted only 1 play. And there's still lots of time left, and it's up to the offense again to control the ball and run the clock. And they do that by running Brian Thomas. On 3rd and 6, Marino has to put it up. He does, but it's only good for 5.5. And that brings up a big decision. 4th and less than a yard. Go for it. Sneak it and get it. 1st down. Boston College still smells that upset. When Brian Thomas fumbles, BC has it at the Pitt 41, still with over 6 minutes left. On 1st down, Sal Cinceri makes what he thought was another big, big play. But the official says incomplete instead of interception. And Boston College is still threatening. On 1st down, Flutie goes to Benjamin, but Dan Short gets him for a loss of 2. But watch this play by Doug Flutie on 3rd and 12. He turns a loss into a big gain. And it's 1st down at the Pitt 21. Now it's back to Brennan. Number 13 gets it down to the 13.
That clock is for you, let's go!
And it's time for another big play by the defense. 3rd and goal at the 8, Michael Woods comes up with the biggest sack of the season. 4th and goal at the 23, the 40-yard field goal attempt is wide, and Pitt still holds on to the 5-point lead. Still lots of time left. The Boston College defense held again, and Flutie improvises his way to another big 1st down near midfield. On the next play, Flutie throws into Pitt territory at the Pitt 47. The Pitt defense held to make it 3rd and 10 at the BC 47, and what looks like an interception by Rich Kranak is wiped out by offsetting penalty, intentional grounding, and roughing the passer. So the pressure isn't off the Pitt defense yet, but Al Wenglikowski takes a little pressure off by putting a lot of pressure on Flutie. And this one wasn't decided until Flutie's last pass is broken up on 4th down. The Pitt defense got tough when it had to, and with Penn State's loss in Miami, you just may be looking at the number 1 team in the country right here next week. Last week, Pitt got a good lesson in what can happen when you take a team too lightly. And after what happened at Boston College Saturday, Jackie Sherrill has to be wondering if his team has learned that lesson yet.
We kept on giving the ball back to him. We kept on fumbling the ball or he turned it over with an interception. And those things you just can't do. You just keep doing that, then you're gonna give the ball back enough times and they're gonna do something with it. And they came back and did.
And this game had to be an emotional drain for the Pitt players, too.
All the guys knew in the huddle that we were going to hold up. It was just about a matter of keeping our composure and just keeping things together. So we held up, and we won it.
When you throw interceptions and when you make mistakes by fumbling and throwing interceptions in your own territory, consequently, they're going to come back and give it a good run for your money. And that's what they did. And they're a tough football team, and they deserve all the credit in the world because they gave us a hell of a game today.
Next week, Pitt plays Rutgers for the first time in its history. And Rutgers is another Eastern school that has been trying to upgrade its football program.
These small teams are the ones that can make it hard for us. So this is a game that we just got to get up for mentally.
What Rutgers likes to do best is throw, and the man who does that is Ralph Leak. Leak is a drop-back passer with a 50% completion rate, and he's thrown for 5 touchdowns. The team's leading receiver is also the leading rusher, tailback Albert Ray. He's caught 24 passes, and he's averaging 4 yards per carry. Panther Pride has been brought to you by Westinghouse and the 140,000 Westinghouse employees worldwide. By Light Beer, everything you always wanted in a beer and less. And by Gulf Oil, who suggests you try Gulf Super Unleaded, the gas with guts. It helps eliminate knocks and things. The executive producer of Panther Pride is Richard L. Clouser. This show was produced and directed by Doug Kennedy. Creative consultant, Guido D'Elia. Associate producer, Bill Dickhouse. Production and technical facilities by TPC Communications, Pittsburgh. This has been a TPC production.